solid ground is falling out underneath my feet. Between the black skies and my red eyes, I can barely see. And when I feel like I've been let down by my friends and my family, I can hear the rain in my ear. And the eye is open.
Control this morning, if we'll just let him be. Amen. Y'all stand together and fellowship the choir as they come down. Amen. You may be seated. This time we're going to sing. Maybe I need to stand you back up. Everybody just stand back up. Remain standing. If you're not already set down, we're going to sing, "It Is Well With My Soul." It is well with my soul. How many would say it is well with their soul this morning? Amen. Amen. It is well with my soul. Hymn number 339.
Mark chapter number four this morning. Ask the Lord to bless our time and to help us to do what He has asked of us to do. It is good to be in the house of the Lord and ask God just to help. But I do want to make mention, just pray for Brother Nikki and all of them as they are over there. And it's Monday over there sometime, probably, or they're in the bed right now. So you pray for him. He'll be jet lagged and when he gets back. Whatever the Lord is telling you to do, son.
You know, I sat there in the pew and the Holy Spirit just pounded on my chest. And so don't shoot the messenger. A while back, I left a job, a really good paying job for my family, to sell out for what the Lord wanted me to do. And I took a job making a whole lot less money. And I've been really worried of how am I going to keep up the bills that I allowed myself to take on from my other previous job. Well, one night the Lord laid on my heart, I was watching C.T. Townsend, and he was preaching on Help Me With My Disbelief. And I was listening to C.T., he was preaching on your disbelief of faith. Do you have faith in the Lord that he's going to pull you through with what you've asked him to do? And as I sat there and thought about that, I thought, well, why am I worried about my bills and stuff when I'm doing what the Lord asked me to do? So, you know, if you come down to the altar and you pray and you ask the Lord to help you in a situation, or if you're at home praying or in your car, wherever you're at, and you get done praying and you get up, and 20 minutes later you're still worried about the same thing, do you have disbelief? Because I've been there. It's how much faith and how much love do you have, trust in the Lord above, that he's going to answer and help you through your hard times or whatever your situation is. You know, so as I've got closer with the Lord, praying, you know, to help me with my disbelief, is if you pray, when you pray, if you'll put 100% faith in God that he's going to do it, you know, the Bible says place your burdens on him. It doesn't say place your burdens on him, then go back home and worry about it. Right. Give it to him, wipe it off your mind, and carry on. Amen. So that's all we can do. And I'll leave you this one thing that C.T. said. He said there was a lady who had her house built beside a mountain. She got no sunshine. She prayed. She said, Lord, move that mountain, because all you got to do is have enough faith the size of a mustard seed. She got up the next morning, and the mountain was still there. And her words was, that's what I expected. So she never expected the Lord to move that mountain. She didn't have enough faith in the Lord Jesus Christ to move that mountain. So if you're struggling with something in your life today, whether it be marriage, your kids, somebody's on drugs, somebody's on alcohol, whatever the deal may be, you know, when you go to pray, pray with 100% faith that you know that the Lord can carry you through it.
Amen. 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 Trust the Lord with all your heart.
Too many times we lean upon our own understanding and don't acknowledge him in all of our ways, but that's what he tells us to do. So Mark chapter number 4, if you will join me there, that's where we'll be, and ask the Lord to help us this morning. The Lord laid this on my heart yesterday. I've been praying and seeking the Lord what he would have for today, and the mail didn't come in until yesterday morning, and spent time with him and asked the Lord to help. But we're going to look at Mark chapter number 4, and I'm going to give you the Word of God. You've got the Bible in your lap, and that's what Brother Nikki gives you. That's what your Sunday school teacher gives you, is the Word of God. So my question to you from this point forward in the service is, how are you going to receive the Word of God? There's different ways of receiving it. There's some that won't receive it. Indifferent. There's some worldly hearers that won't hear it, but there is one that will hear it. And if you hear it, it will make a difference in your heart and in your life. We are not to continue just as we are. The Word of God changes us. I don't care if you've been saved 5 years, 5 minutes, 50 years. It constantly, God constantly, through His Word, through His, the power of His Word, through the instruction of His Word, challenges us and changes us, and we cannot remain the same. And God has laid this heart, this on my heart this morning. So we'll look at Mark chapter number 4 and verse number 14, and we'll go back and look at a few more verses of Scripture. But He is instructing them. He's talking about the Word of God, how we receive it, how we will hear it, what we will do with it once we get it, and we are accountable for what we are given. So Mark chapter number 14. Verse number 14. I'll get it right here in a minute. Mark 4:14. It says, "The sower soweth the word. The sower soweth the word." What we're doing, it's a picture. If you go back over, He talks about, He gives the parable. He's telling them what the parable is, that the sower went out to sow, and He's throwing seed. This morning, I'm throwing the seed of the Word of God in your heart. Your heart is a ground, and it's either going to be, you're going to receive it, you're going to reject it. He starts revealing what He told them. They didn't fully understand what was going on, and I'm reading the part that He's revealing what He said to them. It said, "The sower, a sower soweth the Word." It says, "And they are, they by, and this, are they by the wayside, where the word is sown, but where they have heard, Satan cometh immediately." You ain't going to make it to the parking lot. He comes immediately. You ain't going to wait till the song's sung. He said He comes immediately to take away the word that was sown in their heart. Immediately. We say we got time. If God speaks to you, you better get up. You better move toward God. You better get on this. I don't care if I'm preaching. I don't care if they're singing. I don't care what's going on. There is nothing more important than you doing what God has sown in your heart. If He sows salvation, you better get it. If He sows, whatever He sows in your heart, you have to move immediately. He said, Satan, Jesus is saying this. He said, Satan immediately comes and takes away the word that was sown in their heart. And this are they like, likewise, which were sown on stony ground, who, when they had heard the word, immediately received it with gladness, and had no root in themselves, and so endured but for a time, just a little while. They didn't last long, because it sprang up, and afterward, when affliction and persecution arose, for the word's sake, don't miss that, for the word's sake, for the word's sake, immediately they were offended. And they are they which were sown among the thorns, such as heard the word, and the cares of this world, and the deceitfulness of riches, and the lust of other things, entered in, choked the word, and they became unfruitful. And these are they which are sown on good ground, which is heard the word and receive it, and bringeth forth fruit. And we're going to talk about that. Bringeth forth fruit. Some 30-fold, and some 60, and some 100. Let's pray. Father, we love You. We praise You. I ask Your blessing on the reading of Your word. I pray that it would find a lodging place. Lord, the seed has been sown. Lord, it has gone forth, and I pray, Lord, that You would help us to understand what You're wanting out of us today. Lord, we're not here by accident. We're not here by mistake. Lord, You knew before the foundation of the world was ever laid, before the mud seals ever dried. God, You knew we'd be at Pooveys Chapel on Pine Mountain. Lord, You knew when we was coming. You knew our heart. You know where we are. And God, I pray, Lord, that it would just bring conviction. I pray it bring convincing. Lord, I pray, God, that You would work a work in our midst today, and we'll give You honor and glory for it. As we think about these verses, we love You, Jesus. Help us. Amen. As we think about these verses, this parable, how our heart is going to receive God's Word, I ask you today, how will you receive God's Word? I don't mean to be ugly. I don't mean to be hard. harsh. I don't mean to be critical. I just understand where we are. There is some come in with a predetermined mindset that I'm not changing. I don't care what takes place. I've got plans. I've got my life laid out. I do not care what anybody or anything says. I'm just going to do it. I'm not going to change. But we have to understand that we need to get on God's page and not my page. I need to get on God's program and not my program. I need to hear from the Lord. We need to know and understand a few things before we go forth. And I'm gonna go through this as quickly as I can. We know according to Scripture that the Word of God is settled in heaven. It's settled. It ain't changing. God is not changing for me or you. That's Psalms 119:89. The Word is forever. That's Isaiah 40 and verse number 8. The Word is fulfilled. That's Matthew 5:18. And then also in Psalms 119:103, it is sweet. He said it's sweeter than honey out of the honeycomb. Praise God. It'll help you this morning if you will allow it. Psalms 119:105 says it is a lamp and a light unto my feet. Psalms 119:11 says it'll keep us from sin. And it is all authority. The Word of God has and is all authority. And that's 2 Timothy chapter number 3 and verse 16. It is sharp. It is powerful. Hebrews 4:12. It will also not return void. That is Isaiah 55:11. That is the power of what we're talking about this morning. That is the power of God that leadeth unto salvation. That is the power of God that'll break the chains that has you down. It is the power of God that changes man. It is not a mere thought that in your mind, I gotta do better. You can't do better until you get the power of God in your life. And it comes through the Word of God. It don't come through works. You can work. That is not going to change your heart. It is the Word of God that changes a man or a woman to be what God wants him to be. You say, well, I'm a pretty good person. If you ain't in the Word, you're not. You'll never be what God has intended for you to be without the Word of God. Why is churches floundering? Why is churches struggling? Why do we focus on the negative rather than the positive? Because we're not in the Word. The Word of God has become dormant somewhere, and it's laying somewhere that is being of no effect. We have to understand the power in the Word of God, the might in the Word of God, and ask God to help us to receive that Word. God has a Word for you. God has a Word for me. If you are saved and you are living your life and you think the Christian life is dull or boring, you are doing nothing. Because you're not in the Word, it's not challenging you, it's not changing you, it's not doing anything because you're not in it. You gotta get in it. You gotta get in the Word of God. The Word of God. I'll tell you how powerful it is. Wednesday night we had a youth get saved in youth. Woo! The Word of God. I'm telling you right now, it's the Word of God that makes a difference. It ain't plans, it ain't programs, it ain't what I do, it ain't what I've done. It's the Word of God. And we need to understand. So my question to you is, how will you receive that what can change you? And if you're saved, listen, I'm saved this morning, but I'm telling you the Word of God pierces me. It's sharper than a two-edged sword, and it pierces me sometime. It convicts me sometime. It convinces me sometime that what I'm doing is not what God would have me to do. It is sharp enough to take it off you this morning if you will receive it. You can't, we ought to receive it gladly. See, we look at conviction as a bad thing, but I'm telling you, conviction is a glorious thing. Because that is a loving God telling you, this is it. This is your instruction. This is how you need to be living. This is what I expect out of you. This is what I want out of you. I died for you. So the Word of God, praise God, will not return void. You say, well, I ain't going to listen to you. You say, I ain't listening to nothing you're saying. Well, that's up to you. But the Word of God is going to accomplish that what it's intended to do. Whether you yield, whether you don't yield, God's Word will not return void. It's powerful. You ain't ain't going to stop it. I hope and pray. You say, well, I won't think about it. Praise God, I laid on my pillow before and I didn't want to think about it, and I don't have to think about it. When the Holy Ghost gets involved in it, you'll think about it. Hey, you'll start remembering things you wished that you could not. But let's look at the presentation of the parable. Verse number 1, Jesus begins to give them the parable. He begins to teach again, the Bible says. He gives them a parable. In verse number 3-8, he tells us it falls by the wayside. I know a church, they named it Wayside. After I studied this, bless God, I'd change the name of the church. Amen. I don't want to be in the wayside. I want to be where it'll grow. I just don't want to be somewhere out there. Wayside Baptist Church. I shouldn't have said that, but praise God, I done told it. Hey, I ain't going to tell you where it's at, but I know where it's at. Praise God, I've changed my name. I seen a church one time that said Corinthian Baptist Church. Bless God, I've changed the name. Amen. But it says that they fell by the wayside, and the fowls came and devoured them up. Stony ground, no roots. I'm just giving you an outline of this, just trying to go through it. Fell among the word fell among the thorns, and some fell on good ground. The purpose of the parable. See, that first point went by pretty quick, didn't it? You say, wow, we're going to get out early. Don't count on it. Amen. The second thing I want us to look at is the purpose of the parable. Why does Jesus talk to the disciples in parables? Why did he give them? He tells them, verse number 11, to make known the mysteries of the kingdom of God. And then it also tells us in Matthew 13:14 that it would fulfill the prophecy. Jesus ain't doing stuff just to twiddly wing and pass time by. What he done with a purpose. The purpose was revealing the kingdom of God to his disciples. And then they come to him and said, we didn't understand the parable. We didn't understand it. And thank God Jesus, being gracious, reveals the truth of the parable. And he gave the parables also because Isaiah told him he'd give parables. He's fulfilling the word of God. Jesus didn't come wasting time. Jesus came about the Father's business. Praise God, we oughtn't to waste time. We ought to be about the Father's business. We must come to the place. Now, that's my second point. You say, boy, we're cruising pretty good this morning. Verse number 3, the third point is where we're going to get bogged down. It'll be all right, though. I want us to look at the points of the parable. What is the point? What is the point of giving this parable? Verse number 15. I want us to consider, number 1, the indifferent hearer. The indifferent hearer. I'm telling you, before I even go further, we are living in a day of indifference. You can tell people what the Word of God says, and they are indifferent to what they say. They say, well, some preacher on TV, some preacher on the radio said I could do this, I could be like this, and it was okay. I don't care. The Word of God is the Word of God. I don't care what preacher says that it's something different than what God has said. And see, people in my life that I've seen will be against something. They will take a stand and be against it until it happens to them, and then they change. Now, let me ask you this. Real hard test here. Who changed, them or God? Them. The Word of God will not change. He said, I change not. I don't care if it's 2018. I don't care if it's 1818. I don't care if it's 3545. God will never change. The Word of God is a bedrock. It ain't going to quake. It ain't going to move. It ain't going to change. God ain't changing for me. God ain't changing for you. He ain't changing for nobody. So if you got to go hunt down a preacher to get them to condone how you're living, God help you this morning. Get in the Word of God. You don't need a preacher. Amen. I've had people tell me, come to me and ask me something, and I'll say, well, the Bible says, and you know what they tell me? I know what the Bible says. All they want me to say is what'll make them feel better. That's all. And I want to tell you something. The Word of God is the Word of God. It's the standard. If you come to me And I tell you, I think you ought to do this. You can throw it in a wastebasket because that's what it's worth. Nothing. But if I come to you and I say, well, the Bible says, you better perk your ear up and you better listen. Amen. Quit being indifferent to the Word of God. It ain't gonna, you say, well, I don't like that. Take it up with God. Take it up with Him. Don't fuss at a preacher. Don't get mad at me for quoting the Bible. Amen. Well, I don't like that. I ain't going down there no more. Well, take your toys and go home. You still gonna stand before God one day, and the Word of God will be the judge. Amen. Praise the Lord. Indifferent. Told you we'd get bogged down on the third one, didn't I? Amen. That's all right. Look here, the indifferent here. Satan cometh immediately. That rascal, you say we're at church. I'm going to tell you something, that rat's running around in here somewhere. Because some of you brought him with you. Huh? Some of you brought him, he come in with you. Because of the way you've been living. You say, I don't like that. Take it to God. Don't write me an email and fuss at me about it. Just deal with it. Hey, that rat's in here. He said the Word of God, the soul went out to sow the Word. The Word is being proclaimed. The Word is going forth. And he says, and immediately Satan, so Satan's in here somewhere. Satan's going to come to you and he's going to tell you, hey, you don't have to listen to him. You don't have to listen to that bald-headed guy. Hey, you know, you just keep doing what you're doing. Hey, I'm telling you, Jesus will never tell you to just stay like you are. Jesus always is working in our life. He taketh the word that was sown in your heart. So I know it's there. I know it has found a lodging place. According to the Word of God, He said it was sown in your heart. God let it break through the hardness, and He broke through everything, and He got in there, and He planted it in your heart. And here comes Satan to say, phew, I'm going to take it away from you. He said immediately. It ain't got time to grow roots. It ain't got time to spring up yet. He takes it immediately. You say, well, I know what I ought to do. Well, why ain't we doing it? What are we waiting on? Well, I don't know what we're waiting on, but praise God, quit waiting. The Word of God is plucked out of your heart. It's pricked. It pricks your heart. But the liar, the deceiver comes and takes the word out of your heart. Pay attention to the Word of God. Now, if you get mad at me at this, y'all just get mad at me or whatever. When I was full of the Holy Ghost when I was writing this stuff down yesterday, everybody left the house, it's quiet, and the Holy Ghost sat down with me, and I was just writing this stuff down. So if you get mad at me, you just have to take it up with God. Don't get mad at me. I want to say, first of all, I want to say, pay attention to the Word of God. Put your cell phones up. Amen. I got three amens. Put the cell phones up. The Word of God's being preached, and you're indifferent. You say it don't matter. Yes, it does matter. It's determined between heaven and hell. Put your cell phone down. Leave it in the car. You say, I can't put it down. I'm addicted to it. Leave it in the car. You're going to go to hell over a cell phone. And Satan laughing the whole time. Amen. I'll try to get off of that. Stop being distracted. Stop being distracted. And I put down there, who's causing the distraction? Quit going to the bathroom 19 times. Amen. I'm going to preach. Y'all can get mad. Y'all can stall up if you want to. I'm preaching. This is my time. God said, you do it. And I said, yes, sir. Run in out of them doors 19 times. Hey, for you people back here is like me. Praise God, I'm ADD. I look at a fly across the room. And you got 19 people coming by you, in and out, up and down, all this stuff. I want to tell you something, them doors ought to stay shut while the Word of God being proclaimed. Amen.
Amen.
It is for your soul. And then we run to the bathroom. Go to the bathroom before you come in here. You know you what's getting ready to take place. You ain't got to be running in and out. That's excuses to get out from under the Word of God. Indifferent. You say, that ain't important to me. It don't apply to me. I'm going to the bathroom. There ain't nothing going on in the bathroom more important than what's going on in here. Take your girlfriend and make many boys. together, so I say girls, and y'all go in there and talk about whatever y'all talk about when you go to the bathroom. I ain't never understood all that anyway. It ain't no important than what's taking place in here. And we've got to quit being indifferent to the Word of God. I mean, I'm glad you're here, but I'm telling you, if you're running in and out, up and down these aisles, sit down.
That's right.
Amen. Pick a good day to preach that day. Ain't nobody moved yet. Amen. Amen. Sit down. Ask God to speak to you. We ain't in here wasting your time. We ain't in here talking about cowing and sales and everything else that's going on. We ain't here talking about the Word of God. Something that'll change you and make you different. Make you a new creature is what it'll make you. During the altar call, I'll turn around so you'll say I won't look at you. During the altar call, stay set down. Bless the Lord, the most important time of the service, and it looks like the mass exodus going out the parking lot. I'll hit another thing while I'm here. You said, boy, I'll be glad when Nikki gets back, he come back. When you get out there in the vestibule and they're doing an altar call, you shouldn't be out there. I'll just go ahead and say that. Stay in here. It might help you. What if somebody back there or somebody up here and get under Holy Ghost conviction to get saved and you get your junk and you walk out? You know what you just told them? I really don't give a flip what happens in here. I got to go to the steakhouse. I got to go to the fish house. I got to go down there because it's more important than an altar call. You can at least pray. If you ain't coming to the altar, you can at least pray and ask God to speak to you. And God's Holy Ghost, come and speak to us. Come over here about every day this week and prayed. I was going down that aisle right there yesterday. I was about middle ways down there. And the Holy Ghost showed me something. And I'm going to tell you what He showed me. Holy Ghost told me, He said, y'all like a ship. This church is like a ship sitting on a sea. It's got its sails hoisted, but there ain't no wind. He said, you're just drifting. He said, you need to pray. The wind will blow. I don't know about you. It helped me. I said, Lord Jesus, blow. Blow, Lord, on my heart. Blow on this church. Move us. You say, wait a minute, preacher, wait a minute. The church is doing a lot of good things. Yeah, but we got to have Him. We got to have Him to move us. We got to have Him to direct us. We got to have Him to go where we're supposed to go. Indifferent. We got to be indifferent. What are they doing my glasses? I don't even know. Praise God, I've lost them. Oh, praise God, thank you. Praise God, hallelujah. I thought, what'd they do with them? Praise the Lord. So don't leave during the altar call. Don't. You ain't saying anything, but you're saying a bunch. Amen? And it ain't just today because I'm preaching. It'll be next week and the next 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 and go on. Amen? Y'all all right so far? God has a plan. God has a purpose. We have an indifferent here has no desire for the things of God or the plan of God. But you think you got it all figured out, man. I'm here to tell you this morning, you ain't got nothing figured out. You're in trouble. You're in trouble. And God's here to tell, He told me, I'm just opening the mailbox, putting it in. I can't help how high the power bill is. I just deliver the mail. So don't get mad at me. I've never got mad at Duke Power. Well, I have. I said, I'm wrath. What are they doing down there? Amen. But you know what? I ain't got mad enough to cut them off. Amen. Still pay it. Still do it. Amen. Secondly, the emotional here. The emotional here. I'm going to say this, and I don't mean this ugly. I'm trying to bring forth truth. That's all I'm trying to do. I ain't trying to hurt nobody. I'm trying to help you. If I didn't love you, I'd just get up here and talk about lollipops and rainbows and unicorns and everything be fine. But that ain't me. Because I love you. I care for you. The emotional here. We see it a lot. We see it a lot more than you think. We see it a lot, and I don't mean this ugly, and them teenagers, all my teenagers, all my youth know I love them, and I don't mean this ugly, but it runs in teenage years. but it also runs in adult years. That you're in a service and you get emotional, you get hyped up, you get pumped up. They play music for 3 hours and 35 minutes and get up and breathe the word of God. Somebody comes and somebody else comes and then it's a tidal wave. And then you come down and you make professions that won't last till you get out the door. But they made a profession of faith, so it saved them. Wrong. And I'm just here to tell you, there ain't no root. There ain't no growth. There ain't nothing happening. Listen to me. From the love of my heart, I'm trying to tell you, if your salvation did not change you, you did not get it. It didn't get it. And that's across the board. That's from the preacher to whoever in the pew. I'm telling you, if it ain't enough God to change you, then it didn't. If you went right back, the proverb said, a dog returneth to its own vomit. It goes right back to it. That give me 15 more minutes of preaching. Amen. A dog, you know what they do, and then Proverbs says they go back to it. I'm here to tell you, if you went back to your vomit, whatever it is, you may not call it vomit, but God would. It's keeping you from Jesus. It is vomit. And you return right back to it after you made a profession of faith, and it is emotional here. Look at verse number 16 and 17. Verse 16 and 17. The emotional hearer. It says right here, and this are they likewise which soweth among the stony ground, who, when they heard the word, they immediately received it in gladness. There was some rejoicing. There was, man, yeah, that sounds good. Man, I'm going to do it. Emotional. But look at verse number 17. And have no root in themselves, so they endured but for a time. Pull up the emergency brake and listen to me just 5 seconds. If you got it, it ain't lasting just a couple of days. It's going to last forever. It's going to last throughout eternity. It's going to last through eternity. Not just for a little time. Come for a couple weeks. I've seen it since I've been here. People come, make professions of faith. I got saved. Go through the baptism waters. The FBI can't find half of them. And you want to tell me that they got it? According to the Word of God, they did not get it. And we are deceiving ourselves and fooling ourselves to think they got it. And when they die, we're going to say, oh, they made a profession. I remember when he or she come to altar, and then they come for a few weeks, and then I don't know what happened to them. They got out there and gone. Neil Walker said about Alexander County, he said, everybody that dies in Alexander County goes to heaven. Live like hell, but they preach them in heaven. I said, same thing in Caldwell County. He had enough guts to say it, though, when he was a preaching. He said, something's wrong with that. He said, you make a profession and then you go live like hell for 55 years and you won't tell me you're saved? Something ain't adding up. It ain't adding up to the Word of God. It's getting quiet in here, but that's all right. Quiet don't bother me. So we need to understand the emotional here. They come a few times after they make a profession of faith and then they're gone. And then it says, verse 17, it goes on. Look right here. This is very important. Don't miss this. It says, afterwards, when affliction or persecution arises, listen, don't miss this, for the word's sake. They ain't fussing at you because of something else. They fussing at you. You just talk about the Bible all the time. You just think everybody ought to get saved. You just be quiet. I don't want to hear about the Bible no more. While we was in Gatlinburg last week, somebody threatened to shoot me. I said, if you'll just answer my question, sir, I'll leave you alone. He said, you're going to leave me alone if I have to shoot you. I said, I think I'll mosey on down the road now. He never answered my question either. But he did answer my question. I asked him if he is a believer. He said, I believe a lot of things. I said, you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ? He said, my mama told me I wasn't ever to talk about that, religion and politics in public. I said, well, I'm asking you. I said, are you born again? And he started talking about something else. I said, you never did answer. He said, I said, if you'll answer me, I'll leave you alone. How do you answer? He said, oh, you're going to leave me alone. He said, if I have to shoot you, you'll leave me alone. I said, okay, dude, you got it. Amen. It says, when persecution, affliction, or persecution arises, for the word's sake, immediately they are offended. Immediately they are offended. Persecution. Persecution arises for the word's sake. Well, bless your heart. That hurt my feelings. My goodness. I've had doors slammed in my face on visitation. I told her, that's a first. He made the first. That's the first time anybody ever told me they were going to shoot me. I was like, I guess I got on his nerves. You know what I pray, though? You know what I pray? I pray he can't get away from it. I pray when he pillows his head. I don't know. I don't even know his name. But I hope and pray when he went home tonight, sometime in the night, when he ain't thinking about nothing else, I hope he'll hear, you're a believer. You're a believer. You're a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. You're a believer. I hope he can't get rid of it. I hope it drives him crazy till he repents. Amen. No, that don't make me mad. That's just being, he's lost. You threaten to shoot somebody. You pretty serious about it, ain't you? Amen. The affliction means to be troubled or burdened. Troubled. How many in this life has never faced trouble? Would you raise your hand? That's what I thought. Unanimous. I don't care who you are. As long as we're living in this world, they're going to be trouble. They're going to be family trouble. They're going to be trouble. They're going to be car trouble. It ain't the devil. It's just trouble. Amen. Amen. Jerry loves it when I have car trouble because I take it to him. He says, yes, old preacher. I took it to him a couple of weeks ago because I had a rat get in my motor. That rascal eat more stuff, didn't he, Jerry? I couldn't believe that. I got him, though. I got him. I put a little prize out there for him called poison. Amen. He got it. Amen. Jerry said, I love it. That's just more money for me. Come on. He said, amen. He said, plant them rats out there, brother. Keep coming on back. Affliction, trouble, burden. How many in here don't have a burden this morning? Worried about something. Worried about a family member or something, a crisis. Persecution arises for the word's sake, and they are offended. Matthew chapter number 5, verse number 10. Listen to me. I'm trying to help you. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Did you hear me? You're going to be persecuted. Jesus said, I should have wrote it down, Jesus said a servant is not greater than his master. He said, if they persecuted me, they'll persecute you. He said, if they've kept my words, they'll keep yours. I'm telling you, in this world, you shall have tribulation. Whoever said getting saved is going to make you hop down a lonely trail pop with no problems. Whoever told you that? Some preacher on TV? Send me your money. Put it behind a picture. Put this cloth. Roll on it. Ain't got nothing to do with a stinking prayer cloth. Would that be an idol?
Sure would.
I believe it would too, sister. We're going to trust this cloth. I got it because he swiped his sweat. I don't want his filthy cloth. Wipe his sweat on, send it to me. I don't want it. I'd rather have Jesus than anything. Keep your prayer cloth, give me Jesus. Amen. We've got to get to the place that we understand that persecution for righteousness' sake. You hear me and hear the language of the Word of God. It ain't because you persecuted because you blowed up at work. Amen. You showed yourself out at work and you got mad and you stomped and you slammed the door and then they persecuted you for it. That ain't what he's talking about. He said you're persecuted for righteousness' sake because you pray over your meal and ain't nobody else in the office doing it. You praying. Hey, you say, I can't work on Sunday. I got to go to church. I'm going to church. Hey, and they say, well, I run their mouth about you. I'm persecuted for righteousness' sake.
Amen.
You say, I don't cuss. I can't listen to that dirty joke. You walk off and then they persecute you for it. For righteousness' sake.
Amen.
Not because you got mad and showed yourself. It's because you're standing up for Jesus. And then they talk about you. He said, listen to the result. Praise God. Talk about me all you want to over dinner. Amen. He said, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Woo! I'll take it. I'll take it. Thirdly, you say, praise God. How many more you got? Just one more after the third one. Amen. That's two when I graduated from South Caldwell. Amen. A worldly hearer. I do believe that we have emotional hearers. I believe that they get under emotional because they know they're lost. They know they need to do something. They come make a profession, try to get fire insurance, and God don't give fire insurance. He gives salvation. Okay? And we get emotional and we respond and we say things and we do things and we don't really mean it. We're just in an emotion and we do something. Anybody in here ever been emotional? Anybody not been emotional? I'll bring a hammer and lay your finger up here and pop it one time. We'll see if you get emotional. And you'll hop around. We're all emotional. But what we've got to understand, we cannot deal with emotion when it comes to spiritual things. We've got to deal with reality and fact. And that's where we're missing it. People believe all kind of stuff. Somebody told me last night there's a guy who believed in UFOs. I said, UFOs? Some people believe in ghosts. I believe in the Holy Ghost. These young people tell me the building's haunted. Trina's shaking her head. I said, I'd walk through that church with the lights off. I said, I did one time, and I tripped over a chair down there on the second floor in the middle of the hall. I don't know who placed that thing there, but I found it. Amen. I went flying through. Went flying. Hallelujah. They should have recorded that. Amen. But we're emotional. We get emotional, and we make decisions without facts and reality of who I am and where I am with Jesus Christ. If you're going to make a decision for Jesus, don't make it an emotional one. Now, there's some emotion. I've seen people weep their eyeballs out when they get saved. I've seen a guy get saved one time, didn't shed no tear, nothing. But I've never read in the Bible where you have to cry when you get saved. I've never read that. Y'all correct me if I'm wrong. They don't say, boy, you'll really weep and cry when you get saved. I cry all the time now. People can tell me a story and I cry. I watch stuff on Facebook and cry. My family's telling me I'm turning into a sap. They say, the older you get, the more sappy you are. Amen. I know we're emotional, but the emotion cannot drive me to make a commitment to Christ that I am not willing to keep. If I come, the Old Testament says if I vow a vow unto God, I better keep it. If I tell God I'm going to do something, then you better do it. And see, an emotion, we make an emotional decisions. We make emotion. We're emotional people. We get in the atmosphere. The music's playing just right. The mood's just right. He's so handsome. She's so pretty. And we say, oh, I love you, baby. Emotion. You get outside and you say, I can't even stand to go out with her. And I told her I loved her. Emotion in the moment. We've got to make sure that Jesus is dealing with us in fact of who we are and what's going on in our life. Third, I said I was moving on worldly here. Verse number 18 and 19. These are they which are sown among the thorns, such as hear the word of God. Listen, verse number 19, it says, in the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches and the lust of other things enter in, choke the word of God, and they become unfruitful. Let's talk about this, and I'll hurry as fast as I can. I know the steakhouse is waiting, praise God, or a fish house or whatever. Such as the word of God, the cares of this world, the deceit of the riches, the lust of other things enter in, choke out the word of God, and they become unfruitful. I want you to know there is nothing, 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 young people, there is nothing, nothing, nothing more worth more than going to hell and rejecting Jesus Christ. I want you to know as an adult, there is nothing more important than worth your eternal soul, nothing worth it than Jesus. Jesus is the main thing. Period. Not your work, not your work schedule, not your bank account, none of that. And we're chasing every kind of a dream, other things, We're chasing every kind of thing and everything that has something glittering, sparkling. We chase it and hoping that it'll happen to me or mine or thine. What profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his soul? Worldly hearer. They reject the Word of God. When you reject the Word of God, you are rejecting Jesus Christ. You say, well, I don't know about that. I got scripture for it. I never said it. John chapter number 1 and verse number 14. And the Word was made flesh. Help me, church. Who was made flesh? Jesus. Jesus Christ was made flesh and dwelt among us for the 33 and a half years. And we beheld His glory, the glory as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace, full of truth. What I want you to get this morning is the Word became flesh. Jesus Christ is the Word of God made flesh. What you think about the Word is what you think about Jesus. What you think about Jesus is what you're going to think about the Word. It goes hand in hand. So you can be a worldly hearer and not think. You say, oh, I love Jesus, but I hate that preaching. It'll never work. Never work. Four things he mentions right here. He says the cares, the deceit, the lust, and unfruitfulness. The cares means distraction. We in 2018, boy, you can tell my mind's running. Amen. We in 2018 are distracted by idols. We call them heroes, icons, and we won't call them this, but it's the truth. They are little g-gods. And you say, how do you believe the Ten Commandments? Somebody tell me which one this is. Thou shalt not have no other gods before me. How many?
One.
Everybody jumping up and down over Ten Commandments, but can you quote them? Woo! Preacher shouldn't have said that. Too late. Can't get it back. Hey, man, they're on the wall back there anyway. Right there at the elevator. They there. Hey, man. Hey, man, there's only one. Why are you there reading them? Read that covenant on the church back there. Amen, that'll help us. Worldly hearers. We say, well, you say, preacher, what did you eat last night? Turkey burger. Amen? Turkey burger. Amen, that's my diet now. Turkey burger. Turkey and chicken. And fish. I'm going to turn into a guppy. Amen. Amen. Thou shalt not have no other gods before me. Who's your God? What you chasing? What you dreaming? I'm getting quiet in here. That's all right. We'll run to pillar and post, county to county, ball field to ball field, chasing it. What does it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his soul? Josh Siebert told me, he just got up to the plate one time. He said, that old boy going to throw me a fastball. Josh said he got there. He said, I was waiting on it. He said, I just seen it in his eyes. He's going to throw a fastball first pitch. He said, that thing come down the middle. Josh said, I hit that thing. You told me, he said, it went to the next county. You remember telling me that? And you told me what else? What good did that do? What in eternity is that worth?
That's right.
Nothing. Nothing. Had pro scouts looking for him, and looking at him, calling him, talking to him, car wreck, ended it all. What does it profit a man? What would it do, Josh, good, if he signed a contract, multi-million dollars? You say, what? If I was my boy, I'd be jumping up and down. What if he'd have died and went to hell? With $1 million in a bank account. But I remember, since I've been here, Josh Siebert sitting back there, his mama and papa coming up this aisle, and his papa with him, and him kneeling about right here. Him asking Jesus to come in his heart.
Amen.
You tell me how much that's worth.
Amen.
I'll go with God and leave a baseball somewhere else. You say, you against baseball? No, I ain't. I like it. I like to watch it. But it ain't my God. And it ain't getting in my way between me and God. It's good. If you want to play, play. I ain't against it. Praise God. Tell me when you're playing. I'll try to come watch you. As long as it ain't on Sunday and Wednesday. Amen. Sunday night, I ain't coming either. I'll be at church. Amen. Amen. Praise God. While he hears, he's trying to help us. You say, you're meddling. Take it up with Jesus. He's the one who said it. He said, that we'd just get it this morning. That we'd understand who he is. The deceitfulness, the delusion. We chase things that ain't ever going to happen. We chase things that ain't real. It's like Satan puts a ghost out there and we start chasing it and we chase it. We chase it our whole life. We chase it. And then all of a sudden when you think you get it, it's gone. When I was working for Winn-Dixie, when I was a young man, they kept pumping us, man, that deceit. They kept saying, man, you're going to manage stores. You're going to make a bunch of money. You're going to do all this. You're going to go to Charlotte. You're going to end up in Jacksonville as a main warehouse. Man, they got planes. They got helicopters. Man, they fly you everywhere. Man, you're going to do it. Y'all doing good. You chase it. I don't know how many times I'd be standing on the rug thinking, praise God, I'm going in. And Satan come and go, phew. You ain't getting it. Out of all of us boys, I can name you handfuls. I know one that made it to Charlotte. I know one. Out of all of them deceitful lies, out of all of that chasing, out of all of that dreaming, out of all of that working, out of all of that stuff, Satan says, you're going to get it. Look at the money, look at the cars, look at the house, man, look at them managers' house, man, they live down there, they're living in North Lakes, that's where North Lakes is, a big place, you know, they say, look at it, they invite you over to the house, man, they got nice stuff, they got nice furniture, they got nice everything, nice cars they're driving, and you say, man, it's driving me. It starts driving me instead of me looking to God. I didn't ever equate, what if I died, what if I go to hell, until I was at a concert, standing on a bench, flicking a big ladder, saying, whoa, and God slipped up behind me and told me, if you die, you're going to hell.
That's right.
I got that boy I was with to drive me home. I was setting up, I had a Jeep. I was setting up holding the chicken bar. I said, look, I say, the car pulling out the side of the road here. And the car coming. He looked at me and he said, what's wrong with you, man? I said, I was going to go to hell. That's what's wrong with me. I said, am I going to make it home? I said, God done told me I was going to hell. I'll tell you what, it didn't settle too good with me. I'll tell you that. I wondered, I'm about to say tonight, praise God, I preached that long, ain't I? Thirdly, the deceitfulness, the emotion, it makes us emotional, it moves us. Listen, here it is, right here, the deceitfulness. Let me ask you this, how much fruit you got to show forth for God? That wipes out your bank account, that wipes out all this other stuff, wipes out all of it. We got to get past that. What have you done for Jesus Christ? Who have you told about Jesus? Has anybody followed you to church? Has anybody ever followed you in salvation? Is it making a difference? Thirdly, is the lust, and I'm hurrying, I'm going to kick it in overdrive right here. The desire, the longing, the craving, the covet, you covet it. Man, you can taste it. The panning after. You remember Proverbs, or Psalms said, the deer panteth after the whirlwind. What are you panting after this morning? What are you... I gotta have it. Man, it's gonna be good when I get it. He said, that's the world to hear. The next thing is, I want to see the last one, is the fourth thing. It's unfruitful. Barren. It's unfruitful. You have nothing to show for your Christian life. You're not witnessing. You're not reading. You're not testifying. You're not doing anything. God's not speaking to you. You're just going through the motions. And God is not dealing with you. The fruit you bear is, the fruit that you're bearing is not of God. But we need to understand that it is important. Isaiah chapter number 5, I was going to have a slip over there, but it's way past the time to do that. Hey, he talks about wild berries. This man plants a vineyard, gets a vineyard, fences it in, puts a wine press in it. He does all this stuff. Read it today. He does all this stuff, and when he planted it, he's expecting berries. He's expecting the good grapes. He's expecting good things out of it. He's even got the wine press ready. But something happens in that field. He starts producing not berries, he starts producing wild berries. I looked that word up, wild berries, it's poison. It'll kill you. What are you producing? What are you chasing? Is it giving you life, or is it going to kill you? Is it going to bring glory to God, or is it bringing glory to you? Is it going to bring honor and glory to the name of Christ, or is it bringing honor and glory to you? Hey, that's what he's talking about. We're living in a day and a time where Christians are not even producing fruit. We think it's a drudge and a bore. We're ready to go. It's 15 after 12. Let's go. No, souls are being hanging in the balance of heaven and hell, and we're playing games in the church. We've got to understand this thing's winding down. If it lasts 20 years, if Jesus don't come in 20 years, I wonder in 20 years, if God lets me be here when I'm 73 years old, I'm going to say, who was here the morning that I preached on the souls? Who's here? I don't want to scare you. Half of us won't be here or more. We're coming out of here. You say, I'm young, I'll be here. You may and you may not. You go look at them tombstones out there in the graveyard. They some teenagers out there. They some young men out there. They some young ladies out there that never made it to 40. Hey, I'm just telling you the truth. The truth will set you free and not bondage. I ain't trying to hem you up in bondage. Praise God, I'm trying to set you free. Death brings forth death and destruction. What you're chasing, are you producing fruit out of it? And I'm not going to read all of this, but it's in 2 Peter 1. You read it. It talks about, he gives you the what not to chase after and what to lay aside and what to take up. This thing, he ain't keeping us in the dark, is what I'm trying to tell you. He's not keeping you in the dark to what he wants you to do. He said, but if he that lacketh these things are blind and cannot see afar off, and have forgotten that he was purged from his old life. Have you forgot that you've been saved? Are you barren? Are you bearing? Are you barren? Bearing the works of darkness, or are you bearing the fruits of the Spirit, the Word of God? I close with, give me the liberty of closing, of reading four verses. I'm going to get Anna and them to come play, get ready. Give me the liberty of reading four scriptures and I'll be done. Ephesians 5:11 says, and have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness. Oh, Satan's making it glitter right now. He's turned the lights on. He's got the Ferris wheel going, and it looks pretty good right now. He said, have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. That means correct them. That means fix it. Verse number 20 talks about the good fruit. The receptive here is on holy ground. It has been blood washed and blood bought. John 12:24. Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bring forth much fruit. Can I ask you a question this morning? Have you died once? If you're not, you're alone. He said it has to die being alone. You put one kernel of corn in, and you cover it up, and it dies, and it brings forth a whole ear of corn, much fruit. John 15:5 said, I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me ye can do nothing. John 15:8, herein is my Father glorified, listen, that you bear much fruit, so shall you be my disciple. Mark 4:9, he said unto them, he that hath an ear, to hear, let him hear. My appeal to you today is he that has heard the voice of God today, let him hear. If you're lost, you need to be saved. If you're playing games at the foot of the cross, you need to make things right. I don't know if you're born again, if you're saved. I don't. That's God's work. I don't know. If you tell me you're saved, you're saved. But I want to tell you something. If you're saved, you're going to bear fruit. According to Scripture, you're going to bear spiritual fruit. You're not going to talk. We're not going to bring forth gossip and backbiting and hatred and talk about this and talk about that and talk about everybody. That ain't a God. I know that ain't good English, but it ain't a God. Amen. So my appeal to you today is, how will you hear the Word of God? Let's stand. Father, we love you and thank you for the Word of God. Lord, may it go forth. The soul went out to